Okay, so we're going to start talking about dual y-axes and why we should never really use them. And as I mentioned in the introduction, these are super popular for whatever reason. Maybe it's because they're really easy to make. Maybe because it feels like it should be an intuitive thing. If we want to get two variables related to each other, we can just put them on the same graph. And you'll see this all the time in the wild. And they're fun because they tell all sorts of stories about the relationships between two variables. For instance, if you look at this plot, this is actual data. The divorce rate in Maine and the per capita consumption of margarine in the United States are actually highly correlated. If you look at the correlation variable, it didn't include it in this graph, but it's something like 0.99 is how closely they're related, which is really, really closely related. But that's actually a very spurious correlation. And it looks like they're correlated only because the graph creator here on purpose made it so this y-axis over here and this y-axis over here are shifted around in a way that makes those two lines line up perfectly. If you look, the margin consumed axis goes from 2 to 8, which seems reasonable. Over on this side, it goes from 3.96 to 4.95, which seems way less reasonable. That was only selected to get these things to line up. And so just by doing that, by shifting things around on the two axes, you can get lots and lots of unrelated data points to line up perfectly. There's a whole website dedicated to this. This came from this guy, Tyler Vigen, or Vegan. He has a website called Spurious Correlations. If you go there, he has a whole bunch of different data sets, and he has an algorithm that goes through and finds all of the really closely correlated ones and then makes plots for them because they're funny and interesting. And totally unrelated, but they appear to be related. And so this is super common. But the issue here, when you do these dual y-axes, is it gives you way too much decision-making power as the data visualizer, and so it can make you tell incorrect stories. So one reason why we don't want to do this is because you get to choose where the y-axes start and stop. And so because you have that power to choose, you can force the two trends to line up however you want them to. And so you can force there to be a story even if there isn't a story. And it's not just like these goofy websites that have spurious correlations on purpose. Regular publications do this. So The Economist, they're fairly good at data visualization. They have a whole team dedicated to making plots and graphs. And at the end of the year, they go back and they reflect on the graphs that they've made, and then they do a blog post about it. If you look in the notes for this slide, if you press PE, you should be able to see the notes. There's a link to the blog post where they explain all of their bad plots that they've done in the year. And in this bad plot, they actually did a double y-axis. In the original here, they were trying to show the relationship between a dog's weight and the dog's neck size. And they scaled these axes over on the side from 18 to 21 and 42 to 45 in a way that made it so these perfectly line up. And so in their blog post explaining what they did wrong, they said, we shouldn't have done this. And so then they showed a better version, which still has dual y-axes. And now it goes from, they flipped the neck size to this side and flipped the weight to that side. And it's still basically the same. They just kind of reversed it. But now they're not perfectly lined up, so they don't have a spurious correlation there, but it's still not telling the whole story because again, why 18 to 21? Why not 10 to 30? They just had to choose that, and it showed the two plots or the two trends kind of attempting to show that they're related, but they might not be, and there are better ways to show that. And so this happens all the time. You might have supervisors in the future that say, I want to have a plot with dual y-axes, and you might have to do one. The nice thing about R, or one of the nice things about R, is it's very, very, very difficult to add dual y-axes. It's actually like impossible built in. The only way to do it is to do one of the legal versions of y-axes that we'll talk about in a few slides here. But if you want to do a plot like this in R, you have to do super hacky things to essentially make two separate plots and then kind of overlay them. And you have to do all sorts of crazy code to make this happen. And that's in part because Hadley Wickham, the guy who invented this ggplot package, did not want there to be the ability to add two unrelated y-axes for this specific reason. He didn't want people telling stories that shouldn't exist. So avoid it. Double y-axes happen all the time. You can also get things like triple y-axes. This is from a published paper in Economics and Political Science showing the relationship between economic growth and technological growth and labor movements and labor force participation. And so here you have three different trends, employment levels and labor share in non-farm businesses and labor productivity. And so what these authors are saying is that these three are related. And the way they're related, like you can tell, they're all on top of each other. But if you look at the axes, this output per worker growth goes from 0 to 4. This scale goes from 0.8 to 0.95, and then this scale goes from 0.56 to 0.66. So they're all totally different parts of the scale. And so they zoomed in to make it so that these lines all line up. There may be an actual story here, I'm not sure. But the way it's shown here, it almost kind of forces there to be a story, even if there's not. So again, avoid this stuff. It is legal in one specific circumstance. It's when the two axes measure the same thing. And this is helpful if you want to have two versions of the same axis. For instance, in this plot here, this is from, I think, my dissertation research here. It shows how many times people in a survey that I administered selected one of these options. And so you can get the raw counts down along this bottom x-axis. So it's technically a y-axis, I just flipped the plot. But if you look at the top here, there's a second axis that's the percents. And so this is just a transformation of, or the percents are just a transformation of the total. It's the actual number there divided by the sum of whatever or however many times people selected things. And so this is fine because one, it's not forcing that second scale to be on a different chunk of the scale. And two, it's just a different version of that same scale. It's just a transformation of it. Another good example of this is with temperatures. If you look at this plot, this is using that data from the Dark Sky website that you used in the example yesterday, showing high temperatures in Atlanta for all of 2019. So over on this side, you have Fahrenheit. And so you can see the temperatures get up to the high 90s here, or low 90s, and then it starts dropping. So on this side, you have Fahrenheit, and on this side, you have Celsius. They're measuring the same thing. Celsius is just a mathematical transformation of Fahrenheit. There's a math formula you can use to convert Fahrenheit to Celsius. So that's all it's doing here. It's just converting from one scale to the other. It's not a completely different scale, and that's totally fine to do. It's helpful often to have both scales on there. Doing this in R is a little bit complicated, in part because they want you to avoid doing it. But in part because you have to use a special function. So if you look at the code here, this is the data from the uncertainty example that we went through yesterday. And so we just do a normal ggplot using that weather data set, using time on the x-axis, temperature high on the y-axis. And so we get, using a line and a smooth line, we can see changes in temperatures. The unique thing here is the scale y continuous function here. This is what lets us manipulate the y aesthetic with the scale here. So what we're doing is there's one argument in scale y continuous called secondary axis or sec axis here. And you can use this argument to add a second axis. And you do this with another function called sec underscore axis. It's kind of confusing, but that's just the way the syntax is. And so here in this sec underscore axis, you feed a formula. And this reinforces the idea that the second axis is really just a mathematical transformation of the first axis. So here in this formula, this tilde thing means formula. So we're taking 32 minus, that dot is a placeholder for whatever value is in Fahrenheit. So it's 32 minus the Fahrenheit value times -5/9. And that's the formula for converting Fahrenheit to Celsius. I found that by going to Google and searching convert Fahrenheit to Celsius, and Google told me that. So hopefully it's right. And so that's all it's doing. It's using this math formula to convert this side to these numbers. And because of that, it's totally legal, and that's fine. It improves readability. You can also do this for bar plots. So this is just a count of the number of cars with these different types of drives. So four-wheel drive, front-wheel drive, and rear-wheel drive. And so if you look at the plot here, we make a smaller data set where we're just getting a total number, we're getting the count of the cars by drive. And then we're going to plot that data set. We're going to put drive on the y-axis, or x-axis, total on the y-axis. We're going to fill it by drive so we can get those colors. Use geom call like normal to show the bars. And then this is the new thing here, where we're adding the second axis. And the transformation we're using is we're taking whatever values on this side and dividing it by this variable we created here called total cars, which is just right here, we took the sum of the total of cars. So it's the total number of cars in the data set. All we're doing is dividing 50 by however many cars there were in the data set. So that's going to be 20%. So there's probably like 200-ish cars in the data set. A little bit more, because 100 is about 43-ish percent. And so now we have both of these scales on the sides, and that works. If you don't want to, if you can't add a second scale because it's not a linear transformation of the axis, because it's a totally different variable, there are other ways of showing multiple variables on a plot. The nice thing about the grammar of graphics is that you've been introduced to the idea where you can take different variables in your data and map it onto different parts of your plot. So one alternative is to use a different aesthetic. This is one reason why the Gapminder dataset is so cool, is because they're really good at mapping all sorts of different variables onto different aesthetics. So here we have health and wealth, and then population is also on there. They could have added a second plot or a second y-axis here for population, and then showed population over income, or put year down at the bottom and showed year, or showed population over year and life expectancy over year. They could have gotten like four different lines on there with four different y-axes, but that's not very interpretable. This is far more interpretable because it's just the one y-axis, but they've encoded other variables differently. Either as size or as color, or in the animated version of this as time, where you can actually watch the animation and see things move. And so you can get all sorts of data shoved into this graphic here without resorting to dual y-axes. Another alternative is to use multiple plots. So in this example, this is a timeline of two different things. This is from some research I did with my PhD advisor on anti-human trafficking legislation around the world. And so this is showing, this top plot shows how criminalized human trafficking is in, this is Honduras here. So you can see they're kind of adding more legislation, it's getting better, and then they start repealing some legislation. And then down here, the US State Department gives countries a score with how well they're taking care of human trafficking in their country. Tier one means they're doing great, tier three means they're doing really poorly. And so every year, new human trafficking reports come out and new rankings come out. And so down here, you can see how their rankings in these trafficking in persons reports changes and how that's related to their policies changing. This could have been done as a dual y-axis, and we could have put the tip rankings as like a different color on here and then had the tip rankings over on this side. But then that's, again, I would be able to choose whatever scales I want to get those to line up to tell a really cool story that is not true. In this case, because they're using the actual scales that they're supposed to, we can still get them to line up. We're just using multiple plots to do that. And the cool thing about that is you can actually overlay as many plots as you want. This is technically four different plots, not just two. Here's one, this policy index, the tip ranking is one. This timeline of presidents in Honduras is another little skinny plot that I put at the bottom. And then this top, these labels here, this is another plot that was just labels. And so I got everything to line up. And so you can see like personal criminalization happened here, right at the end of President Maduro's term. Full criminalization happened here, right in the middle of President Lobo's term. And so you can get all sorts of information. Again, like this is a rich plot, even without all the fancy aesthetics added to it. But it's still not resorting to dual y-axes. And so we, again, don't want to do that. Doing this sort of stuff in R is actually really easy. There's a package called Patchwork that lets you just add ggplot objects together. So here's an example. If you look at this library Patchwork package, if you Google R Patchwork, you'll find the documentation for this package. It's super great. Very, very well written. There's all sorts of examples of how you can make fancy plots like this. The way I did this is I made the temperature plot. And so that's just the temperature over time with geom line and geom smooth using temperature high. And I just stored this as a plot object called temp plot. And then I made a second plot that shows humidity over time. So I really just changed temperature high to humidity, saved that as a second plot called humid plot. And then down here, the nice thing about patchwork is if you want to put the two plots together, you use the plus sign. And so it's just temp plot plus humid plot. And then there's this plot layout thing that lets you control how they're added together. By default, it'll put them side by side. So you'll have temperature on one side, humidity on the other side. But with this plot layout thing, I'm making it so it's in one column, so it's on top of each other, and you can actually control the heights. And so here I made this temperature plot be 70% of the plot, and this one be 30% of the plot, just to give more emphasis to the temperature here. And so you can see that there's not really a relationship between humidity and temperature. You can see it's generally more humid in the summer. There are drier days in the spring and winter, but that doesn't really have an effect on the temperature. And so we could have overlaid this again. We could have had humidity over on this side, and you'd see a squiggly line here, and we could line up the humidity numbers to kind of make it follow the temperature, but we don't want to do that again. That's telling incorrect stories. But this is far easier to read and interpret than having multiple lines on there. And so this is an example of a good way of doing fake multiple y-axes. So moral of the story, don't use dual y-axes unless it's exactly the same measure, just different scales. And that's how you can avoid miscommunicating your information in your data.